Okay, sorry about that. My computer decided to be a jerk. So we're back. I had to like restart it several times. So the same thing with Instagram here. So let me get that set up. Here we go. Okay. All right. So I didn't do anything while I was gone. So we're gonna start exactly where we left off. So that was paint. So I have my paintbrushes. I'm gonna get my water and the paints. Okay. Great. So let's get started. Let me erase a couple extra lines here. All right. Cool. So, you know what? I'm gonna make the neck a little thicker real quick. It's looking a little too skinny for my taste. There There we go. That's a little better. Okay, let's get started. So I think I'm gonna do the Spinosaurus since this dinosaur was just so big and it would want to probably blend in under the water. We're gonna do it in like a muddy, brownish olivey color that would probably blend in really well if it was living in like a swampy estuary kind of place. So I'm gonna mix some red with green, a little yellow in there, maybe a little orange to warm it up a tad. There we go, that's a cool color. And we're gonna start at the nose and we're gonna work our way back. All right. I'm going to give it a little bit more orange. There we go. And ever so carefully, I don't know if you can see. Here we go. Okay, I'm going to ever so carefully get in all those little nooks and crannies that I drew on my own. It was my decision to do them, so I got to deal with the consequences of painting them in. I'm gonna wet my brush, gonna smooth out, give it some counter shading. Go back, start doing the sail and then the shoulders, go down to the arms. There we go. I'm gonna mix a little bit more colors together because I'm running out of paint. Okay. Red in there. Here we go. Right, get in the rest of the sail here. Back leg. The tail. All right. And then finally, I'm going to counter shade it again by putting some water over the line. And that's what I ended up with. So it's kind of muddy and brownish and greenish looking. Really good camouflage for an animal that's ambushing prey under the water. All right. So there we go. Why did I draw the sail in the C shape and not the N shape? Because there's just, like I said earlier, I just kind of did whatever. I've drawn the M shape, I've drawn the C shape. They're both similarly accurate from what I'm understanding. We just don't know enough about it. So that doesn't really matter either way. Okay, so let me move on to the ground part or the bottom. So I'm actually gonna do that in a similar color. Might make it a little darker. So I'm gonna mix a little bit of black in there, but not too much. And I'm just gonna very carefully, or actually not carefully, because it can be sloppy because it's like a muddy water, bottom of the river, bottom of the swamp kind of environment. So it's probably fine being a little on the muddier, messy side. In fact, what I'm gonna do is I'm even gonna raise some of those parts up to make it look like there's like dead debris down there. So you see how I did that down here. Looks like there's like piles of dead trees and stuff. And I'll do the same thing on the other side. I'll even do like some branches sticking off of one, so it's showing that that's clearly a dead sunken tree. I don't know if Instagram saw that. Sorry. Here you go. Cool. There we go. And now I'm gonna kind of draw like a little dust cloud. And the way I'm gonna do that is I'm gonna take my wet brush with paint on it, and I'm just gonna use the side of the brush to like just make a cloud of like silt and sand and mud coming up because this Spinosaurus is kind of launching itself off the water's floor, the riverbed, maybe to come up for a breath of air. And it looks like a big messy cloud. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a little bit of that dark blue and black and mix it with the brown. And I'm going to apply that to the bottom of this cloud so it gives it some depth. And then I'm going to still take that same dark bluish black color. And I'm going to paint that very loosely, not in a straight line at all, over the bottom here to give the impression of a shadow. All right. Let's see. Let's paint some details on our Spinosaurus while we're waiting for that to dry. So I'm going to go back and I'm going to mix like a dark brown together. A little bit of green, a little bit of red. There we go. And I'm going to paint some markings on our Spinosaurus. So I'm going to maybe give it some like banding on the tail to help break up its form a little more. And if you look at like the tails of like some crocodiles, they have this same pattern. So again, banding colors and stripes, they help break up an animal's shape even more. So it's harder for other animals to tell where they start and where they end. And that's helpful because the more Spinosaurus can throw off other animals in the water, the more effective it will be at hunting them. So like fish and maybe some small crocodiles or things like that, it might want to eat, might not see it coming right away, or might not even see that it's there if it was maybe an ambush predator. And then I'm going to move these bands into the sail maybe a little bit. I already did a little bit of variation in the sail. Maybe a spot here. I'm being very fluid and very kind of free with my patterning right now. I'm not really sticking to any one particular neat pattern. Kind of just drawing little blobs and using whatever I kind of think of in the moment. And that's cool. It actually makes for a really neat camouflage scheme here. So yours could look completely different from mine, but that's okay. All right, and then we can move it on to the face. Let's see. some here, some a little bit on the neck, and then we'll do some on the snout. I'll do some banding across both jaws of the snout. Maybe that'll help break up its form to any like fish that might be swimming close to its mouth. So kind of like a snapping turtle does, its mouth, the inside of a snapping turtle's mouth is the same color as the outside of a snapping turtle. So most animals, when they open their mouth, they're the inside of their mouth and their tongue is like a lighter color, usually pink. But not a snapping turtle or an alligator snapping turtle, I should specify. Their skin and their scales are blackish brown, and so is the inside of their mouth, because underwater they keep their mouth open and they sit still, and a little fish swims by and it doesn't realize that that's a turtle mouth. And then when they get too close, they grab the fish. So maybe Spinosaurus hung out in the water with its mouth maybe open a little bit and just stood there, holding its breath. And maybe when fish got too close, it snapped them up too. Who knows? Okay. And I'm also going to paint the eye. And I'm going to do the eye also like a brownish color. Because again, just like a snapping turtle, I'm inspired by snapping turtles right now here. The eye could be the same color as the skin. A lot of times animals have like a brighter eye than the outside skin and their flesh. But snapping turtles, their eyes are like a dark brown color and they kind of almost blend in with the rest of their face. Again, so it doesn't stand out. So a fish doesn't recognize that it's an eye. It thinks it's like a log or something. All right, so now I'm going to imply that this Spinosaurus is underwater. Now, you might think, oh, this is going to take forever. We're going to have to paint blue over the whole painting. But no, we're not. I'm going to show you what we're going to do. We're going to do like a little trick. So I'm going to take a pretty big brush. Now, the water I'm going to do here, it's not going to be, when everyone thinks about water, they think about blue. But, you know, water is not necessarily blue. Water is just reflecting whatever color is in the sky. So if the sky is bluish, then the water will be like a bluish color. But sometimes the water in the ocean looks green or black. And if you're in a body of fresh water, like a swamp or a lake, the water can sometimes be brown. So water can come in a lot of different colors depending on what's in it and what's around it. So this water is going to have some, I'm using blue for some of it, but I'm also going to use a lot of green because there's maybe some algae and stuff growing in there. There we go, like a muddy, excuse me. Bluish green. Now, I need a lot of water in my paint. I'm using a bigger paintbrush. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to start painting like wavy lines, like wave shapes, over most of my picture. So I'm starting on the top there. And I'm going to keep going with this. And maybe if you're not working with watercolors, you can do something similar with colored pencils or crayons or something. Okay, and I'm going to make sure that they're wet because I don't want the color to be too thick. Because I'm actually going to show you. I'm going to allow some of these waves to get in front of the Spinosaurus. And I'll show you what that looks like in a second. And then I'm going to go back to painting around the Spinosaurus with more waves. So here's what I have so far. So look, I painted a lot of waves around the Spinosaurus, like thick. And then I went in front of the Spinosaurus and painted a few waves. And this is implying that the Spinosaurus is underwater. But it's not like, it doesn't look too flat. So I'm still making the background look more dense with that blue color, but still implying that the Spinosaurus is under the water by having still some, but not as much blue lines in front of it. It's a neat little trick that you can try if you're doing any kind of underwater scene. Maybe one day you decide to paint a fish or a whale or a manatee or something. You can use this same technique. There we go. There we go. Cool. Okay. So here is our Spinosaurus. I'm gonna smooth some of these out. Okay. So there's our Spinosaurus. Now it's gonna take a little while for this thing to dry, but it's looking pretty good so far. All right. So while we're waiting for this to dry, I think what we can do is we're gonna add something else to the scene. To imply that this is the air on the top. So I'm gonna take my pencil again, and I'm gonna maybe draw in like a couple little birds. So Spinosaurus lived during the Cretaceous, so the later part of what we call the dinosaur era, the Mesozoic. And by the time the Cretaceous rolled around, birds had already evolved. So birds actually coexisted with a lot of dinosaurs. So if you were to go back in time and look for the time of Spinosaurus, or even later, like T-Rex and Triceratops, you would see birds flying around. So I'm going to do some little birds. Now, we don't really have many fossils of birds, and the ones that we do are very fragmentary. But we can imply that there were definitely birds, and we can still imply that there were some birds that were like water birds, land walking birds, similar to like the modern rail. If you don't know what a rail is, look it up. It's a really cute little bird with a long beak. So these guys are going to be kind of like water birds. And I'm going to have one maybe kind of sitting on the top. And I'm going to show you what I draw in a second. So here's what I drew. There's a little, looks like a little duck on the top. Now this isn't going to be exactly a duck, but it's going to be kind of the same idea. Well, maybe I'll draw another one. So here's my first bird, and it's kind of duck-like, but the feet are bigger. And it's just kind of hanging out, and it doesn't even know there's a big old Spinosaurus right underneath it. And this bird is actually pretty big, if you think about it. If that Spinosaurus is about 50 feet long, that bird is actually a pretty large bird. It's maybe like the size of a hawk or an eagle or something. And then I'll draw another bird, maybe on the other side of the paper, kind of coming in for a landing, with its wings stretched out behind it, the tail. There's another bird there. Okay, flying, maybe about to land. Maybe some pterosaurs fished. The pterosaurs from the area that Spinosaurus is from, if I remember correctly, the most well-known ones were like as darkids. So they had long necks and long pointy beaks, and would have been like waders, if anything. The ones that would have been like in deeper water would have been more like pteranodon, which didn't live with Spinosaurus, but I think it did have some relatives. But I'm going to stick with my birds here, and that's fine. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to paint my birds. So we can make our birds colorful. So let's see. I'm thinking maybe we can do like some reddish color or some orange. And we can give them like multiple colors even. So I'm going to make maybe the head of the bird like reddish orange, goes down into the front. There we go. And then maybe I'll give it, how about like black and like a blackish green on the wing. There we go. A little bit on the tail. And then I'll make the beak like a pinkish red. And you can make your bird any color you want. Birds come in so many different colors. And since this is an extinct bird, it doesn't really have to be the same color as any bird alive today. And I gave it pink legs too. So there's my bird colors here. So it's kind of like an orangey head, a little grayish black, and like a pink beak. Pretty cute. There's my flying one there. Just chilling. Okay. All right, is this Spinosaurus almost dry? It's getting there. We can add some more to the environment. This time, I think we're gonna add some fish. So it is underwater, so I'm gonna pick a dry spot where the paint is mostly dry, and I'm gonna add in, I'm not gonna draw with a pencil. I'm going to draw a fish. Now the fish I'm going to draw is kind of a special fish, and it's reflective of the fish that lived in that area. So there's my little fish outline, and I did it with paint only. And because I only did with the paint, I didn't do it with pencils, and I'm not going to do it with the marker either or the pen, is I'm implying that the fish is farther away. So just like we did last time with the Quetzalcoatlus and the other pterosaur that was in the distance with less detail, same here. And since we're looking through the water, which has algae in it and stuff, it would be even less detailed. Okay, so we're just going to do some like minor detailed shapes of fish. And that kind of fish is called a coelacanth, by the way. There's a coelacanth that's still alive today. But back then, there were a lot more different kinds of coelacanths that lived in fresh and salt water. And they're what we call a lobe fin fish. So their fins on the bottom kind of look like they had little feet. And they kind of move their fins around kind of like little paddles when they're swimming. It's pretty cool. There are other kinds of fish that live with Spinosaurus as well. We have a lot of good fossilized fish remains from that area. There were some shark-like fish, like a big sawfish. There was other water creatures, like different kinds of crocodiles and turtles around there as well. So Spinosaurus had a lot of neighbors that it would have seen. I'm going to do some fish behind the Spinosaurus. You can do as many fish as you want. All right. Okay. So there's some more fishies in there. And you can paint in your own fishies and make them look as interesting or you'd like them to look. Just remember, the more detailed the fish is, the more it's going to look like it's in the foreground. All right, and then I'm going to paint the claws of my Spinosaurus. I can do them in like a darker blackish gray color. That looks pretty cool. And the toe claws too. There we go. All right. So there's all of our paint applied. Looks pretty cool. And now I'm going to move on to the last step, with my pen. So Spinosaurus still probably could get onto land. It had legs. And just because the legs were short doesn't mean it couldn't walk. Some people think it would walk on all fours. I'm not sure about that. Again, we don't really know because we never found the arms. But assuming the arms were similar to other Spinosaurids, like Baryonyx, it probably couldn't walk on all fours if the arms were the same as other meat-eating dinosaurs. So if that was the case, it probably kind of just very slowly lumbered around on land. And this might be one of the few dinosaurs that actually dragged its tail because it would have been so heavy. That big paddle on the tail would have made it heavier. And also, this dinosaur is very low to the ground as it is. So having that tail up in the air as like a counterbalance wouldn't have really mattered. Like it would with another kind of dinosaur. All right, so I'm going to start going over it with pen. I'm going to give this guy a slit pupil, which is like the kind of pupil that a cat has. If you ever look at a cat's eye, when there's light, the pupil, which is the dark part inside of your eye, gets thin. Now, our pupils are circles. They're round. But cats have like a diamond-shaped one that becomes like a line when there's a lot of light. And animals that have eyes like that can see in the dark. So other animals that have eyes like that are crocodiles, some kinds of frogs, some lizards like geckos, certain kinds of geckos at least. Any animal that sees well in the dark, sometimes they have a slit pupil. So since Spinosaurus was underwater in murky water with low light, it could have had an eye like that too. So I'm going to make mine kind of like that. The eye is so small, it's hard to see exactly. But I don't know if you can make it out, but the pupil is like a line going up and down. Okay, I'm going to keep going. I'm going to start at the tip of the snout. I'm going to do some teeth. And some more teeth. There's a bottom jaw. Here's the throat like kind of like the neck wattle or the pouch or whatever you want to refer to it as. Maybe Spinosaurus had a pouch under its neck like a pelican, or a lot of other birds have a pouch like that too. It would make sense since it was a fish eater, right? And birds are dinosaurs. Spinosaurus is much more closely related to a pelican than it is to a crocodile. That's for sure, even though it kind of looks more like a crocodile and people often compare it to a crocodile. It was not a crocodile and it didn't really have too much in common with one. It had more in common with a bird. All right, moving on to the sail part or the spine. Some lines there to indicate that there's like some folds of skin, not too many folds of skin, because dinosaur skin wasn't really like an elephant's skin with a lot of wrinkles, but it still would have had some folds, most likely. Some crooks in the arm there and the inside of the elbow. The claws, one claw, two claw, three claw. Here's what I have so far in the front. You can see it's the front half of the Spinosaurus is bolder than the back half. That's the part that I have done over with the pen so far. Some little more fold in the shoulder there. Okay. Here's the, I'm moving on to the tail, the underside of the tail. All right. The back leg. Okay. And I'm also going to outline that little bird because he's in the same level in the scene as the Spinosaurus with regards to how far or close away it is. How close away, that doesn't make sense. How close or far it is, far away. I'm going to draw a couple waves on the surface there. Okay. And then the last thing, I forgot the shading step. Silly me. So here's the outline so far. Looking pretty good. And now I'm going to shade it. I'm just going to take my pencil. I'm going to shade it with the pencil, like I usually do. And I'm going to start shading under the throat here, which is a little tricky because all those little wrinkly bits are sticking out. But I can still do it. Under the snout, under the eye, nostrils there, neck skin, the arms have some shading under the claws. Okay. Oop. There we go. I missed a line with my pen. Gonna shade under the belly. Knee, the foot, back foot, under the tail. And note how I'm rotating the paper to better suit where I'm shading. So don't feel obligated to draw at this level all the time. You can rotate your paper around any way you need to in order to do what you got to do. Some artists forget that. All right. Cool. Right. And now I'm going to sign my name right under the tail. And here is our finished Spinosaurus drawing. How cool is that? So it's underwater. It's not necessarily swimming around. I've seen so many drawings. So many artists have already done Spinosaurus since a couple of days ago, because it's just so exciting. So I wanted to make sure, and a lot of them are just swimming at the top of the water or through the water like a crocodile. But I want to do mine at the bottom because I don't know if how well it would have been able to actually swim. A lot of animals that live in the water don't necessarily swim that much. They just kind of walk around on the bottom. Think of like a hippopotamus. So maybe the Spinosaurus is walking along the bottom of the riverbed, and it can swim a little bit to the surface to get a gulp of air and then come back down. And the tail helps propel it to do that. There's a big cloud of dust and silt coming up as it launches itself through the surface. And maybe it's getting a breath of air, and this little bird is about to get a big surprise. Or maybe the Spinosaurus knows the bird is there and is going to try to get it for a snack. A lot of people draw Spinosaurus eating fish, but very few actually draw it eating a bird. I don't know if I've seen any artwork of Spinosaurus going after a bird before, so maybe this is a first. Who knows? But I hope you guys enjoy it. I hope your Spinosaurus came out the way you like. And we'd, of course, love to see it. So please link your own artwork in the comment section. And mention if there's any dinosaurs that you'd like me to do next. So I hope to see you guys next week. We're going to be doing a different dinosaur. Stay tuned on the Facebook group because we're going to be voting again. So I'll see you guys then. Have a good rest of your day. Bye-bye.